Hi, I'm Harold Bell, and this is the Legends of Inside Sports and the Way We Were. We're going to take a run down to North Carolina to talk to one of my dear friends. I think we've been knowing each other for well over 40 years. We go back to the real boxing days with, of course, Muhammad Ali and Don King. You name all the characters. They were there, right there in front of us. This guy is in his hometown, Pittsburgh, native out of Pittsburgh. He is, you know, when you start talking about boxing trainers and the legendary ones, the great ones, the first name comes up, Angelo Dundee, Emmanuel Stewart, Eddie Futch. You know, but there's a young man that we have to add to that category. He is the youngest boxing trainer ever to step in the corner of a world heavyweight champion at the age of 21, I think he was, when while working for Don King Productions, Don threw him into the cage, man. I mean, we're one of the great boxers of all time, and I'm talking about Iron Mike Tyson. And he went on to train, you know, man, I can't even count them all, the champions that he has trained. He's in the International Boxing Hall of Fame, the Atlantic City Baller Hall of Fame. This guy is still out there doing, but I think he's taking on one of the great projects of his career. And that's how we hooked up, got back together. I was happened to be talking to my dear friend, George Roy Foreman, one night. And his name came up. I said, what? Where is he, man? That's my man. Give me his number. And I got the number for the man that's on the phone now, Mr. Aaron Snowell. How you doing, Aaron?
All right. Thank you, Al. It's always an indeed pleasure to talk with you, to be around you, and for you, a legend in your own right with Inside Sports. Inside Sports was Inside Sports when you had it a long, long time ago, and they made a copy of it, but it is nothing but Hal Bell, and it's a deep pleasure to be on your show.
Yeah. I'm honored. Well, it's my honor, man, because, you know, when we stop to think about our relationship with each other, man, it was always real. It was never anything phony. If you gave your word, I could carry it to the bank, you know? And that's what, those are real friendships. And when I think about that, one of my questions to Muhammad Ali, when I interviewed him after the George Foreman Rumble in the Jungle, I asked him, I said, Muhammad, how can you tell who your real friends are? He said, Harold, a friend is someone that is always looking to help others and looking for nothing in return. And I stopped to think about that, man. How many of those people do I know? And, you know, I had to stop counting after about three fingers. So, you know, when I think about what the type of things that I went through during my career and being in Las Vegas, man, which was really, when you start talking about the fight game, that was where it was. And having a friend like you and Carl and Bert Sugar, my man, Howie Evans, I mean, that was it, man. That was it. So, you...
Yes, you tell it the way it is, the way it's supposed to be. You don't sugarcoat it. You don't try to dress it up. You know, if it is what it is, you tell it the way that is, and you have the power of the pen, which you always had, and you write the way it is. And some people don't like like brutal honesty.
Mm-hmm.
And they have trouble dealing with the truth. But, you know, I've always been a believer in God. And my thing has always been, and that's why we get along, from the truth and shame the devil.
Mm-hmm.
and that's why we get along so well, because you always tell it the way it is. And that's the way it's supposed to be. You know, sometimes it's hard for guys that are in certain position with a pocket full of money. Mm-hmm. They like all of that smoke blown around them and blown up where the sun don't shine.
Mm-hmm.
It puts them in a forest. You know, when you're on top, life is moving at a rapid pace. And they like that fog. You know, and that's why a lot of trouble and misery comes to them, because of that fog, instead of dealing with the realities of life, is a natural high if they can't take. Mm-hmm. So they go to try to find other things to try to hide behind taking the truth, brother.
Yeah.
And that's why I love you. Well, however, you know, in your opening, on what you said, you know, I am from Pennsylvania, but a lot of people think I was from Pittsburgh or Philadelphia.
Right.
But the foothills of the Pocono Mountains.
Foothills of the Pocono Mountains. Wow.
From Muhammad Ali's training camp.
Right, that's right, that's right.
I started in the Anthracite Coal League, the Poxel Maroons, and the NFL got started in that region with the Anthracite Coal League, and also it's the home of the oldest brewery in America, Yuengling Beer.
Okay. Wow.
So we're cool. And Anthracite Coal, which is Schuylkill County, is coal country. And back in the day, you know, with coal, there was so much flying around. So that's how football got started. The mountaintop up there where Muhammad Ali's training camp was, that's why he ventured up there. It was the home where a lot of sports got started. And the first black quarterback in the NFL played up there.
Mm-hmm.
And up there in Schuylkill County. So it was fitting for Muhammad Ali to venture up there. And like you said, you know, the International Boxing Hall of Fame last year, it was an indeed honor to be inducted with an extraordinary class. You know, people that mentored me into the game of boxing, such as Muhammad Ali. I went in when he went in, Houdini Brown, George Serrano, and you know, and a host of other great fighters that are legends, to be going in with such a class with them names, you know, I was just honored. You know, and you're right. You know, to be the youngest trainer. When I met Muhammad Ali as a youth, he told me something. He, and with the private training sessions that we had, he said, he told all of us, he said, you can be whatever you want to be. And he said, the belief that there is a God and that all things are possible when you believe in God. So I took it for heart because I was playing sports anyway. You know what I mean? And I took it to heart. And the only reason why I didn't start fighting Harold, when I was young, my father had passed. My father passed in September. And 3 months after that, around Christmas time, in December of that same year, we were going Christmas shopping. My mother, there's 10 of us in our family. 9 of us was in the car, a station wagon, including my mother, which made 10. My oldest brother wasn't there.
Mm-hmm.
Tractor trailer truck hit us head on.
Wow.
And in that accident, surgery.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't walk for 10 days. And my other brothers and sisters, the younger ones, they had scar, you know, cuts and stuff all over their face. They still have a lot of that, the scars today, but the good Lord took care of us. None of us died. Mm-hmm. And people were just amazed that all of us were able to live. But there was a gas station right across from the accident happened, and we were one block from the hospital.
Wow.
And these guys were going hunting. And when the truck hit us, they ran across the street from out of the gas station and ran us a block up the street by foot. They carried us. And that's what the doctors believe that saved a lot of us from crucial injuries.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So, yeah, so a lot of that stuff, like that stuff, now disease, from real bad headaches, stuff like that, from that injury. So that's why I didn't box.
Right. Well, we're talking to Ern Snowell, really one of the outstanding trainers of our time. And I mean, he's a living legend, you know, not one that we have to go back and give his props. He's getting his props now. Ern, one of the things that I am so very fortunate that I was able to get in on this Jack Johnson exhibit on the ground floor with you, because Jack Johnson has always been one of my heroes, always been one of my heroes. The type of man and the type of fighter that he was, and during the time that he came up, man, when you talk about real courage in an athlete and in a man, this man personified courage. You know, he's a man that won the heavyweight championship in 1806, man, and he was his own man all the way through his career. And some of the things that he done were very unorthodox, but you know what? He had peace of mind. He decided that he was going to be a free man. And here it is, 2019, a lot of black men and women are walking around are not even free. And this man was free in 1806. So when you took on this Jack Johnson exhibit, how did you get into this, Ern? And you brought it here to Washington, D.C., Black History Month. And it was fantastic. We had three different venues, one in Alexandria, Virginia, one on the Ridge Road Southeast, and the last one down at the Dream Center. And they were all, man, you did a fantastic presentation, man. I was in awe of you myself. You and Will, man, you guys did a great job. Give us a little background how you got involved with the Jack Johnson exhibit.
Young Muhammad Ali used to talk about Jack Johnson a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Muhammad Ali respected Jack Johnson for all the things that he did and for standing up for human rights, to have dignity as a black man, you know, as he traveled. Jack Johnson was probably one of the first African American athletes to travel the whole world and practice his trade to the world. Also, my mother used to tell us when we were young about what my mother now, next month, thank God, if she keeps on living and God bless her, she'll be 93 years old.
Wow. Truly a blessing.
We grew up in Schuylkill County in Pottsville. We went to school with a predominantly white area. And my mother used to tell us what Jack Johnson said. You have to realize that you're black, you're free, and you're equal, but you can't do a lot of the things that they're going to do because you'll find yourself in a lot of trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And you ain't gonna get away with a lot of stuff, a lot of nonsense. So my mother, growing up from the South, my mother's from the place where Jack Johnson lost his life, in Franklinton, North Carolina. He was coming through the town from being on a tour in a winding road, and that's he had a telephone pole, and that's where he died at. So 5 years ago, I moved down to North Carolina, and when I moved down there, my mother, my cousins, all of them were telling me, go ahead, just fit, you know, do what you were planning a long time since you're down here. And that was about the Jack Johnson thing. So I was at a golf outing one day. It was an LPGA event. And I was volunteering with the nonprofits that I was doing with the event. And everybody there was telling me about Will. Will had wanted to learn to fight and all that. And Will Williams, we start talking, blah, 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 blah. I said, I tell you what. I said, what you want to do? So I told him, did some classes with him and all that. So he was, you know, Will's an actor, film producer, and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So we just hooked up. And we started, we met on Saturdays over coffee. And stuff like that. And I'm a grant writer. I had started a lot of different programs down there, like feeding programs, a free youth summer camp with my cousin Martha Ann and William Hunter, the Sheriff's Department, my cousin John, and we feed over 500 kids in the summer camp, breakfast and lunch and all the activities free for 2 weeks. And in that process, you know, we got awarded a lot of grants. And I was sat and had a board, which was a collaborative board of nonprofits. And the United Way of Franklin County was one of the collaborative nonprofits that sat on the board that I was director of. And through that, we've applied for a lot of grants. So I got wind of, through a meeting, that there was a film funding that was in that county that nobody never applied for. So I talked to Will in our meetings that we were meeting at a coffee shop. I told him, we're going to apply for this grant in Franklin County for this film grant. And we'll get it because ain't nobody applied.
Mm-hmm.
With Jack Johnson, as big as he is, I said, it's a shoe-in. So in that, all the things that with the film we were going to do, we had to talk about it. And there was another gentleman named Rob Underhill, that the film guy, that was with us, and he got sick and had to pull out of the project. However, we were awarded the first funding for the film grant to bring us alive. So there were people in Franklin County that were older, that were still living, that were at the scene of the accident, the guy who towed the car, where the car sit, the people that had witnessed it and were never interviewed on record or nothing.
Mm.
So what I did was interviewed all of them on record as part of the tourism grant for Franklin County, North Carolina. And we were awarded that grant, which made us eligible for the larger funding, which is the Triangle Film Commission that deals with Raleigh, Durham, that triangle.
Mm-hmm.
In North Carolina. So down the road, you know, the major film and all that, we were in line for the major funding for that. So in that, I had stuff already that I had collected about Jack Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
Artifacts and things like that. His book that he wrote, his biography. Jack Johnson wrote his own biography.
All right.
in that. I had the book and all of that. I've been at it and stuff. So I knew a lot about Jack Johnson from reading and studying what he said, but a lot of intense research of I bring other people, the local college and things like that, that help research a lot of the information that we look, that we have about Jack Johnson to bring him to light. And we knew that he had written his own part in 1920 when he got arrested for the Mann Act and found guilty and went to jail. And he was sentenced 1 year and a day, but he had wrote the pardon himself. He wrote the letter to Woodrow Wilson and the Attorney General of the United States. And so what the law system says that once a motion like that is put in legal terms, the twists and turns and how it ends up, no one never knows. Because it's like a wheel, it's always turning. So Donald Trump, last year, he signed the pardon. And with the WBC a long time, with Jose Suleiman, we had pushed it before his death. With legislatures, with, you know, and Obama didn't sign the document. George Bush, he pushed it through the House, but he never signed the document, and Barack Obama did. And so it was just shooing, and the timing was right.
Mm-hmm. Right. We're talking to Ern Slowell, a recent inductee into the Boxing Hall of Fame. He's the go-to man for the Jack Johnson exhibit, exciting and well put together exhibit. Ern, take it, keep it going. I'm listening.
Yeah, well, Jack Johnson is someone special, you know. April 28th of this year, last year I went in the National Boxing Hall of Fame. This year, they're going to induct Jack Johnson into the National Boxing Hall of Fame, and we're going to be the ones who do it, April 28th in Montebello, California.
All right.
So we're going to induct him, and then June 21st to the 23rd in Atlantic City, a part of the Atlantic City Boxing Hall of Fame, for the last 3 years since its conception when it got started, we have taken the Jack Johnson there and exhibited and did interviews with many champions and people and children, like we always do, about the exhibit, what they think once we walk them through and talk to them, they get the presentation and ask them what we think. So it's an ongoing thing. We make it for the people, by the people. Like Don King used to say, your magic lies with your people ties. And Jack Johnson truly is an American icon.
No doubt about it.
They want to say this about him, that about him. Bar none, when John L. Sullivan won the heavyweight championship of the world, he said point blank that he wasn't fighting no niggas. Now, they toned it down because and he used the N-word.
Right.
That's what he said, cut and dry.
Right.
Those after him, heavyweight champions, they took the same thought process, that they weren't going to fight no black fighters, and they did.
Right.
Up to when Burns won the championship, he said that he's taking on all comers. When he said that, Jack Johnson, during segregation, we had our own boxing league. It was called the Colored Boxing League or the Colored Championship. Mm-hmm. And Jack Johnson was the heavyweight champion of that at the time. When Burns said he was taking all comers, Jack Johnson took off and chased him all around the world.
He chased him. That's right. He chased him all around the world.
Burns was from Canada.
Mm-hmm.
Johnson chased him to England, France, and caught up with him finally over in Australia.
Right.
And when he caught up over in Australia, he got to a promoter and told the promoter this was big and they got to happen and this and that. And finally, Burns said, "I'll fight him." And when that happened, when he said he'll fight Jack Johnson, it rang shockwaves around the world. And it was a spectacle, like a Muhammad Ali or a Mike Tyson fight. It was huge like that.
Mm-hmm.
It was a media spectacle. However, there was some news guys from the United States that were sitting at ringside. And when Jack Johnson was fighting, he was taunting Burns, playing with him. Mm-hmm. Saying, "That's what you got, Tommy Boy, bada bing, bada boom, Tommy Boy, this all you have, this all you do," you know, like that.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, whites couldn't take that with a black man, big structure, muscle bound like that, talking to a white man like that. And the writers couldn't take it. So Jack London put on the teletype, send a message around the world that someone had to knock this mama off this Jack Johnson's face.
Looking for a white hope. Looking for a white hope.
Yeah, looking for a white hope. Mm-hmm. And Jeffries was the one that they figured could do it because he was undefeated.
Right.
He had retired undefeated. But the promoters at the time had to go talk to Jeffries because he was overweight and out of shape on his alfalfa farm in California. And they did, and they got him to fight. And the rest is history. Jack Johnson won that fight. And when he won, they cut the films off. They wouldn't let the fight be shown. And the same thing happened in the Burns fight. The police had to, they stopped it. Mm-hmm. So it was a spectacle, and that's how we got on. But we're taking it around, traveling to different places to let people see, to hear, to talk about it, mm-hmm. and to talk about racial things
mm-hmm.
that's in the United States, and through conversation and talking and see what Jack Johnson experienced, to find newer, better ways for America, to make America a better place to live.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Ern, we're running out of time, but I want to take this last couple of minutes to say, if you look behind me, you'll see my heroes, really. And you'll see Jack Johnson, you'll see Jackie Robinson, you'll see Muhammad Ali, I slide it over here, and you see my man, Paul Robeson. These are the guys that really had courage. This kind of courage is no longer seen in America, especially in professional sports. We don't have that kind of courage. And getting back to Muhammad Ali took most of his tricks from Jack Johnson. I mean, you know, his first knockout of Sonny Liston in 1965, and Jack Johnson knocking out Tommy Burns, they almost had the exact same pose standing over their fighter, telling them to get up, sucker. That's what Muhammad Ali used to say, get up, sucker. So these guys, when Bert Sugar rated the fighters, he said, "Man, I had to put Jack Johnson and Sugar Ray Robinson because this is who Muhammad Ali said he took his cues from." These two great, great fighters, and Muhammad Ali, like Ern said, had a lot of respect for the great Jack Johnson. And we all should have that kind of respect. And we all, you know, these guys kept hope alive for us. I mean, what Earn is doing, what I'm doing, you know, I'm on the way out. I'm not on the way in. But I'm still inspired by Jack Johnson, Muhammad Ali, and Paul Robeson, and Jackie Robinson, because these were real black men who stood up for their people. Earn, you got the last word as we get out of here.
Elijah Muhammad said, told to me by Muhammad Ali, and I like to close with this thing, is that history and culture are both my studies. I have to track the best qualified through the person's research, as it takes upon the springs and motives that spell the destiny of the human being.
Yeah. Well, man, a job well done, and looking forward, man, to you coming back here to Washington, D.C., and wish you the best, man, as you head out to California and back to New York and then down to Atlantic City, where I plan to be in June. Is that June 21st, Earn?
June 21st,
June 23rd. Yeah. Now, Earn, one other thing I want you to tell my listening audience about, I forgot to do that in the intro. Tell us about your boxing show that you do. You stream all over the world on every Saturday at 11 o'clock. Tell us a little about your boxing review show.
Well, come travel to the sport of boxing as we travel the world for past, present, and future stars, where you can hear the boxing news, interviews, legend tales, boxing history of past, present, and future stars in boxing. Mm-hmm. You know, myself, the radio aficionado Bob Burry, boxing historian Henry Hathcock, and boxing historian Tony Dream. So you can catch us at blogtalkradio.com/the World Boxing Review, or you can go to www.theworldboxingreviewradioshow.com.
That's right. Well, man, thank you so much for taking time out to be here on Inside Sports. And don't forget, you can go up on Facebook and catch Earn as he promotes his World Boxing Radio Show, heard every Saturday. And don't forget, you can catch me on blackmeninamerica.com, which is one of the top black websites in the country. Out of the 50 websites, Black Men in America is ranked number 14. Also, my individual blog, the original insidesports.blog, and of course my YouTube channel. You can see Earn and myself up there. Well, that's going to be it for the Legends of Inside Sports. I'm Harold Bell, and always remember that every black face you see is not your brother, and every white face is not your enemy. Until next time, you can color me gone.